Appreciate everybody showing up tonight. For those that don't know, my name is Cliff O'Neill. I'm the general plan, one of the general plan project consultants. Our other project consultant is now in Prescott Valley. He has got a job out there and is still in the process of moving his stuff. That's Andrew. So we are, the two of us did the administrative work to putting this together. But most of you folks that are here, except yourself, we had about a 12-month process from start to finish, starting with the community survey. And the community survey results are incorporated into the general plan as well. And the results are actually in the appendices. That was one of the things we wanted to make sure because there was a lot of good responses from that. It was a really good response to that survey. So it's, and then subsequently to that, we had workshops, at least half a dozen seminary workshops, and talking about different topics. And then finally, that culminated in a joint workshop between the Planning and Zoning Commission and the Town Council, and we came up with a vision statement. And the vision statement is in this document as well. So it's and I just got two copies here. This, the draft is on the town website under general plan. So it's
Oh, it hasn't been updated.
No, well, not the one that's not on there hasn't been yet. But I can tell you that it's the cutoff date for, we followed the ARS process. We had to notify area agencies through a 60-day response process. We've done that, and we got one response. And that response was incorporated into the water resources element in the general plan. And it was basically two words. We changed entitlement, changed appropriation to entitlement, and then one other word, just said about tense. So that was the only changes. No other agencies made any responses or anything, so do I take that as good or bad? we did receive responses. So that part of the process is complete. We're done with the 60-day review. We've incorporated those comments. The draft that's on the website doesn't have those comments incorporated into them yet, but the final draft that Planning and Zoning will get, you already picked up your packet?
No, not for this week. Not for next
week, yeah. For the 14th. Planning and Zoning is going to have a public hearing / special meeting on the 14th.
Oh, yeah.
And the copy, the version of the general plan that they have will be the final copy. This one, you'll notice, this is draft all through it. And,
oh, yeah.
And so, because there was only two minor narrative changes, the copies really aren't, you know, they won't substantially change. And but just the draft stamp is removed.
I didn't know I had a packet to pick up yet.
Yeah. So it's, and then that will be, that's with the recommendations from the commission to the council. And then the council will review that same document on the 26th. I better check. I don't want to get it wrong. Yes, March 26th. And then and they will make a recommendation to put on the next council agenda, which will be April 9th, final adoption of the general plan. So there is basically, we've got another 4 weeks to make adjustments to it. But again, at this stage, it has to come through the commission and or through the council. The public comment period, in terms of agencies, that's done. So process-wise, we're almost finished. And then once we adopt it by resolution on the April 9th, then we're done. Turns out the attorney sent an email this morning saying that he's researching it further, but his initial opinion is that we don't have to put this on the ballot, because our growth rate for the last 10 years has been less than 2%. So again, he's researching that, but that's his initial opinion, and that will obviously give us a final opinion, but that'll definitely save us some time and money if it doesn't have to do that. Which in a way kind of makes sense. It's, you know, we unintentionally, when we first started this process, you'll notice it says up, you know, it doesn't say, whoops, or whatever, or page. Oh, this is my copy. You know why this is my copy?
It's upside down.
It's upside down. So, but the, so it is, and which makes, because that's all we saw, because we started obviously with the 2014 plan, you know, borrowed heavily from the 2003 plan, and, you know, and just tried to update everything. As the, you know, there hasn't been a substantial amount of growth in the community, so that was, you know, that was kind of a...
So you're not triggered into the Growth Management Act then, because you haven't met that threshold?
Well, in terms of voter adoption, right. We still have to do the plan or the update. We still have to do that. But in terms of voter approval, we don't necessarily have to. So, but again, we have had a very extensive public participation process. So it's you were asking me about, just for the benefit of everybody else, you were asking me about an airport. And there is a section in here about an airport. And because it was recommended at, I'm not sure which workshop, maybe a couple of them, but I think through some outside folks as well, that we needed to, because it's been in both previous plans, and it was suggested and highly recommended that we include it in this one. So that's one paragraph in there. So it's in the general plan. But as I think, as I'm not sure if it alludes to it in there, but one of the interesting things about how the discussion about a town airport has changed. You look at the 2003 plan, the 2014 plan, yeah, the discussion has really changed over time. And for a lot of different reasons. Initially, there was some problem or issues with the power lines, the WAPA power lines. Those have all been moved now. So they're out of town, but guess where they're at? They're out in the desert. So in terms of the east side of town, it's created some, it's actually removed some opportunities that were previously considered for siting an airport out there. So that's kind of some, there's challenges to that. So, but again, it's in the general plan, and it's up for discussion. Has everybody noticed the map, the town boundary map? This is a result of the annexations that occurred about 10, 15 years ago, or actually maybe 5 to 8 years ago, before Jim got here. They were done when Dan Field was the town manager. And we had to go back through and basically redo them because there were some technical glitches. You know, the state didn't like the way they were done. The county definitely had a heartburn with them. So we cleaned up the processes, refiled them, and being that they had already been started. And the map, this boundary map that you have here, is conforms to all of those annexations.
Yes,
that one. Yep. We had quite a few debates where people, some of the comments we've gotten on this from this map, again, not from the agencies, but from just local folks, can't find anything. You know, it's hard to see anything on this map. Well, I can tell you that one of the challenges is the scale. When you look at the town boundaries, according to that, it really begins to be a challenge to put identifiers on the map and still be able to tell where things are. So you can tell where Highway 95 is, obviously you can tell where I-10 is. I was talking with the police chief last week, what he's actually going to do, and I think in conjunction with Public Works, they're going to get a GPS locator. And they're going to go out to like Plumosa Road, to Dome Rock Road, and identify where the town boundaries are, where those roads are in relation to the town boundary. So we can identify for people, when they're leaving town, coming into town, that type of thing. In the police department and the sheriff department are kind of driving that, because there's always, you know, when there's an accident or something, it's like, whose jurisdiction is it? And they look at this map, and they can't tell. It doesn't tell them.
Is this south?
Yes.
So why is Plumosa Road down here?
It's Plumosa Mountains.
Well, that's up here, Plumosa Mountains. That's out there, but we've got Plumosa down here, which, I don't know if that means Plumosa Road.
No, it doesn't mean the road. That needs to be taken on.
Because this is like where the LTB areas are, right?
Yes. Yeah, everything south of the town boundary is the LTB areas. Yeah, that's not Plumosa Road. We did have an earlier draft where Plumosa Road was shown on it, but it also shows all of the section numbers.
Right.
And it was, and people were saying, no, it's too cluttered, it's, you know, you can't see anything, it's just too much, it's too busy.
Well, if it's Plumosa Road, it would be up here.
Yeah, it's up there. So we are going to do other maps. We are doing other, more detailed maps to show the town boundary. Well, and actually mark on the ground, so when you drive up Plumosa Road, you can tell where, you know, where the town ends and the county begins.
I don't think it goes up to Plumosa Road.
It does. A portion, it's a portion of it, a small portion, not much. But because it's, because our town boundaries are, they coincide with section lines, then it's, you know, once you have a GPS locator, it'll take a little bit of work, but not much. We don't have to hire a surveyor. We just have to get a good GPS locator to mark where the boundaries are. And so again, a lot of discussion about that particular map. The purpose of that map is to show the extent of the town boundaries. And that's all it is. This other map here with the yellow, we almost didn't include that because, it doesn't look like a whole lot, except what it does show is it really dramatizes the extent to which we are surrounded by yellow grid. I mean, that's really, again, that's the purpose for that map, is it's the state land is to the north there. But the reason for that map is just because it dramatizes that map. So, trying to put more detail in there, we did put Main Street in there, so again, to begin to give people some markers as to some identifiers as to where things are. Other maps. This other map here, the growth boundaries map, this one here, this map here is a, it's a smaller area, but one of the requirements of the particular element of the general plan is that we identify areas where we anticipate or would prefer to see growth in the next 10 years. And so that's in what this attempts to show. Is it shows commercial areas, combination commercial industrial, combination commercial mixed use residential. So it shows all of these start areas are out in BLM ground. And in previous maps, they actually had blocks. I mean, they were identified by sections and or half sections or things. We stayed away from that. Especially if we want to encourage BLM to do more land sales, it makes it a little harder for them to automatically estimate the land at a higher value if we haven't specifically identified that block of land. But it's again, the general plan is it's a general purpose idea
of
where we would expect growth to be in the next 10 years.
So, if we buy BLM land, where does the money go?
What do you mean if we buy it?
Was that it, or what do? Trade for it, or buy it, or how do we procure it?
You know, you have to purchase it, and it goes to federal government.
Yeah, and if I understand it right, we can't buy it to resell it. We can't become a land developer either.
Well, that's a problem. So we have to have the buyer. We participate in the purchase, okay, but we actually have to have a buyer to take it out of the county. Recently had a transaction like that.
So that they can actually develop it then?
Well, it depends on the acquisition. You know, there's different types of acquisitions and leases, et cetera. Because some are for governmental purposes.
You know. our prices are out of sight because we have so little land here.
And I don't remember your name.
Oh, Dave.
Dave. Dave was talking about airport. And I was telling him about the last time that the town had a land sale, bailing land sale, or land disposal, at least they'll call it disposal. And, you know, and they haven't had one since that time. And, but I wasn't really sure what, through all of these meetings, through our map here, you know, we are saying, yes, we would like to see more developed, more disposed of. But, you know, is there a formal process for the community? I'm assuming it would be the community, because the town's not going to buy it, so it's going to be the community too. Approach BLM with, yes, we would like you to have, or identify acreage for another land sale, or just, you know, a process.
So the answer to that is yes, and we're doing that right now.
Yeah.
We're in that process already. We've taken the land that was previously identified, because that's the easiest, because a certain amount of work's already been done. Quite honestly, at this point in time, I don't know what the advantage of that is, because it's still taking us 2.5 years on another piece that was previously identified. Because basically, even though they previously identified it and it's on the list, they still go back and go through all of the same steps that they did almost 15 years ago, something like that.
I'm lost. Is that for the airport or is that to procure land?
That's for any.
Any building?
Yeah.
Well, you know, a lot of people not Facebook, and this is off topic, I'm sorry, but that's on my mind. So many people are looking for rides to the Phoenix Airport, and it costs hundreds of dollars. A little shuttle flight would be great for that, or bus service into the airport. Because
there used to be a Yuma shuttle service that did that. I don't know if they still do it or not.
Not out of here.
Not out of here.
Because so many people stay here for the winter. And let's face it, we do have an older bunch of temporary winter people here, and a lot of them would like to go home and fly, but if they could get to the airport easily, they'd probably fly, go home for the holidays, and come right back.
Yeah, we can't do that with our transit service. Transit service isn't allowed to do that. The Camel Express? Yeah, because it's grant funded, it's not a, that's a for, it would be a, it would make more sense for a for-profit service to do. But,
but unfortunately, and that's what you were getting at, is the ones that have tried a for-profit, it's just too expensive.
Too expensive, especially now with gas prices, it's like absurd. It's absurd.
Well, so, it, you know, so, like the bus company used to stop at McDonald's, and they don't anymore, but it's just, I really believe if you offer a service, people will use it. I mean, I see that question asked repeatedly.
They can't make it cheap enough for people to afford. People, I mean, when Candy had her little shuttle that she was doing, you know, she's trying to make a living. So by the time she factors in her wage for her time, because it's going to take her 4 hours round trip, so you figure if she's paying herself $20 or $30 an hour for her time, and then the maintenance and the insurance on her car, now she's got to charge somebody $150 to go into town, and people don't want to pay that. So that's I think where the challenge is for something small like that. I mean, if we could get Greyhound to stop here again.
Yeah.
You know, that would.
They stopped in the middle of the night, but
right.
That a ride's a ride.
Right.
So one of the things that I think is kind of a important on this map is that we are proposing mixed use residential and commercial, and that doesn't mean residential next to truck stops. It means, you know, the appropriately zoned uses and types of uses that could be in closer proximity to each other. And because that's one thing is we're not right now kind of reverting over to the zoning map here. You can see there's, you know, how much residential, yellow is the residential and the pink is the commercial. And one of the things that just kind of jumps out at our current zoning map is we have pretty much 0 acres available for R3 multifamily. It's just not available. And that's one of the things that we stress in the general plan is ways to encourage that. And one of the ways of encouraging that is this mixed-use development, so that there's, you know, with duplexes, you know, fourplexes, there's, you know, apartments. There's ways to do that, you know, and they can be reasonably close to commercial. Again, not heavy industrial, not, you know, heavy commercial, but regular C2 commercial. And that's something the town has never really promoted in the past, but it's a way of, you know, we are getting commercial development along, because of I-10, and so why not, you know, they require workers, they gotta live somewhere.
Gotta live someplace.
Well, we kind of already have that with the RV parks.
Yeah, that's the other thing we talked about in the general.
We're kind of already living that.
Yeah, we already, that's the oddity that the map doesn't show us, which is that RV parks are high-density residential, but they're not identified that way.
Right.
And that's one of the things that we are, you know, we talked about in the general plan is to make that change. If nothing else, just in the color coding of the map.
Yeah.
Because it would immediately just like show people like, oh, yeah, that's already occurring. Yes, yeah.
Would that also allow somebody to convert an existing RV park using the existing zoning to multifamily?
Yeah, well, if it retained its, if they're a C2.
Yes, if they're a C2.
Yeah.
Well, they could do, and our zoning, I'm not sure if there's a formal word for it, I'm going to say progressive, but that might not be the right word. But if you have, it's a step-down type of zoning, you know, if it's whatever's allowed in like in C2 is allowed in C1, right. That type of thing. And so, so it could be, yes, it could be. One of the other things we're working on right now as a result of the general plan discussions is we are, and again, it's another oddity, another quirk in the zoning code, where mobile home parks have a minimum lot size requirement of 5,000 square feet. A mobile home park or a manufactured home park. But yet we have a mobile home subdivision code that allows 2,500 square feet minimum lots. I mean, actually, there is a subdivision in town that did, came out of the States.
Well, there's a difference between a mobile home and an RV.
A significant one. There's a significant difference.
Significant.
Yeah, and the other thing that we're working on is clearing, I won't say cleaning, but clearing up our definitions. Because our code is a little bit confusing. The law has changed, people's ideas have changed about, you know, because mobile homes, the term mobile home is actually restricted in Arizona law by a certain time frame, you know, pre-78 or pre-76.
July of 76.
Yeah, and so it's, whereas everything now is either manufactured housing or modular housing, and so it's...
Yeah, it depends on how it comes in. Does it come in on wheels, or does it come in on a trailer, which is your modular?
Not necessarily. Like, for instance, the community annex building that's right next door, that's a modular building, but it came in on axles. It has axles on the ground under that building, but it's a modular building. Now, how is that different than a manufactured one? Not really much different. So that's kind of the oddity of the definition.
I used to get in, when I did sell real estate, I used to get in arguments. People said, what do you mean my house isn't stick-built? But build a house around it. I said, as long as there's a trailer in there that's livable, it's not stick-built.
Yeah, we've already had, was it with commission or with council? I think it was council. We've had a preliminary discussion about the definitions and the terminology. And so we're going to discuss that further because it's, again, it was brought up during the discussions of the general plan, and it's one of the projects that we're working on, is clearing up those definitions, making it more clear for people. So that's, but yeah, there are some challenges there in some code challenges that we want to address because we don't want them to, again, it was loud and clear through this whole process. We want to remove the barriers to development, even if they're just perception. Even if they're just perceived barriers, so that's a lot of the land, a lot of the recommendations in the land use is that in that regard. What else did we have? The other thing in the growth areas, I got a couple of comments on this on the growth areas map. If you look in the lower left, talks about open space. And again, open space designation is, it's in Arizona statute, and we have it in our town zoning code, and we have it in, it's in the general plan, it's been in all of our general plans. And so we have designated open space, open spaces, let me say it that way. And again, they are areas, you know, not specific areas. But one of the things, when I, you'll notice in the lower left-hand corner there, my Q Mountain, it's identified as open space. Well, one of the comments we've gotten is, well, that's an active mining site. Well, the claims may be active, but I'm not sure when the last time anybody actually mined it. But the Q Mountain itself, outside of the mining claims, is BLM ground. And so it kind of lends itself to, just through the, again, through different discussions, to being preserved.
Would the mining claims have anything to do with it? Because you have to prove those up, I thought, every year. That you could just get a mining claim and say you've got it in perpetuity or whatever. You had to work it.
Yeah, and I don't know what the status is. I, you know, obviously they have mining claims in the past.
I mean, one time I was going to get.
Yeah, and I know that's changed, but
it may not even be a problem.
Yeah, it may not be a problem at all. But again, it's a designation in the general plan, doesn't bind anybody or anything. It's just a suggestion, because Q Mountain is such a popular recreational spot. People hike it on a regular basis, so which lends itself to being, you know, an open space area. And then in terms of off-roading, you can even see it on this map. There's a dirt track behind there that goes off to Rainbow Acres. So it's, you know, it's almost a regular roadway, you know, an off-road path over the mountain, you know, around the mountain. So so that was one of the reasons why we did that. Again, some people misinterpreted the definition of the area, thinking that we were imposing open space requirements on Q Mountain. And it was like, no, nothing we do here imposes anything on currently zoned property. It doesn't change anything currently zoned property. And again, there are some preferences, long-term preferences for, you know, extending Riggles further to the north to eventually tie into Tyson. Pathways, we're showing, there's a reference in the plan about extending pathways, trails and pathways along Copa, Q Mountain, connecting the trails and pathways, Tyson Road, Tyson Street, which will really, and in my discussions with Public Works, you know, they are working on the northwest, redoing the sewer lines in the northwest quadrant of town. So that's been kind of the, you know, you don't want to go in and put in a whole new bike path and trail system and then come along and put a sewer line through it, you know. So that's one of the reasons why that hasn't been done. But it would definitely, once that project is completed, it's under design right now, I think, isn't it? It's under design.
They've been out there scrubbing and cleaning the roads. I wondered if they were getting ready to start working or if they're just cleaning up from winter.
No, that's actually going to be a surfacing issue. We won't go back, I'm told anyway, we won't go back and tear up the road for the actual sewer lines. You know, we have our preservation program, certain areas for this area is now up for redoing, which is basically the entire northwest section.
So you're going to be extending sewer into the northwest?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's the plan. But that's not, you're not going to see anything on that until a good year away. It's in design right now. The earliest the design will be completed will not be until probably November to January, and then from there, you know, so even we move slow on some things.
Is the city able to get grants for that, or how does that impact?
Yes, we have grant money both for the main sewer line as well as, because we qualify as a Colonia community, we qualify for grant money for the individuals then to hook up to that sewer line.
I'm just asking because I've got property up on West Campbell, so that's going to fall into that.
You know, and most of our, I mean, all of our projects, no matter really any kind of a public works project, before any work that's done in neighborhoods, there's flyers, you know, I think they even go door to door, put flyers in people's houses, knock on doors, and let people know what's going on. So, because that's obviously, it's going to be a very disruptive project in that area, that part of town, so. All right, I'm just going to hit some high points here. We've already talked about land use, transportation. Town is working, there's a big section here talking about exit 17, the west interchange on, is that me? Somebody else, who's me?
I turned mine off.
Your battery going dead on your head? So it sounds like a battery board. Anyway, the town is in the process, they've initiated the process to reconstruct exit 17. As ADOT has kind of been a stick in the mud about allowing development over there without extensive requirements and prohibitions on any particular business to, you know, to.
What was that thing called that they were going to do this? What was that? The fourth.
It says it in here.
I can't remember what. What was it?
Diverted diamond.
Oh, yeah. Because they have that at Watson exit now.
Right.
And it's like amazing.
It moves much, smoother because the left-hand turn now is not blocked.
Right.
But the problem we have is ADOT is, the Yuma office still would like to stay with the standard diamond. Just a quick update, you know, we've actually applied for a grant for 100% design. And, but we've left the door open as to whether it'll be the diverted diamond or the standard. The folks in Phoenix don't necessarily agree with the folks in Yuma. But we don't want to continue to hold it up just because, you know, our experience is you finally get an agreement and then they shift the guy from Yuma office to the Phoenix office and somebody else in the, and you start all over again.
And we have an election coming up.
Yeah, that changes things.
There goes the BLM.
Yeah.
So that's in process. That's a, and that if there is any project that kind of fits into a 10-year general plan, that's the project. Because it's going to take, you know, I mean, the fact that it's moving as fast as it is phenomenal.
Yeah.
But it's a longer term type project. It's a huge project as well, and that into town. Other thing we're talking about, we mentioned the airport in the transportation section. We talk about the off-road vehicles. You know, we made sure that, you know, the 2014 plan, we did extensive information on the off-road vehicles, OHVs and things, and a lot, the majority of that has been incorporated into this plan. With the addition of, we now have a staging area. You know, the town was able to get a grant, built that nice staging area, which is, on a day-to-day basis, it's half full, if not completely full. I've noticed it less.
Some days when it is almost completely full, it kind of fluctuates, you know, but.
That's a lot of good use. Housing, again, I've already talked about, we want to remove barriers in the code to encourage as much housing as we can. We identified growth areas. Economic development, we talk about broadband internet, local internet providers, which is kind of a issue for us right now.
Were you here for that one meeting when the one gal came in and made a presentation? And I think she loved talking to herself because this is so unique here. I mean, you know, we just blossom up in the winter and then we drop dead. But it's unique. And I think she was, I literally think she was talking to herself and she liked.
Was that the one that made the presentation to the commission?
She made a really nice presentation.
Yeah, very, very nice presentation.
Yeah.
And, but she was about 3 months later.
Actually, contractor that was hired by ACA to go around the state and get opinions, and try to get a better understanding of the communities that would fit into the state plan.
I don't think we did.
Yeah. But we're in there. I mean, it's a matter of the private sector stepping forward and taking advantage of the funds, the programs that are available. The town itself can't do it. We don't have the money to do it because we want to own an internet system, and I don't think we want to do that.
No.
Because for sure it would go down and we'd be in trouble.
like the last couple of days.
What would change?
Yeah, that's true.
Meanwhile, I'll just keep paying my Verizon bill, which is very high, but at least I have it. Right, maybe?
I would encourage everybody to read, take a look at the water resources element. One of the things that we attempted to do in this was really bring everybody up to speed on what the town has done in the last 10 years, since the last general plan, to really protect and preserve the future expansion of the town by having an adequate water supply.
Yes.
And what we tried to do in this report, in this plan, is just recognize all of the groundwork that has been done. You know, the town over the last several years has more than doubled our water capacity, upgraded things tremendously in terms of whatever the electronics are, for monitoring the operation. And just the fact that by drilling a second large well, we have more than an adequate supply for double or triple the population that we currently have, easily more than that. Because the well we have now is more than adequate for our current population. So, and disagreement on how much what the population is, but the fact that our town water supply is able to handle our winter population, then it's like, what's the problem? Yeah. So now we have another well that doubles that. So and we try to reflect that in here that. Because obviously living in a desert environment, water is always a critical part. The last area that we highlighted was public facilities and services. One of the things that really came out strong in the community survey was medical resources. The community was loud and clear on you want more medical resources of all kinds, human and veterinary, in this community. And so, I can tell you that just from Andrew and I, kind of brainstorming on the questions and everything, there were a couple of questions we left out. One of them specifically that we left out, and knowingly left it out, was on water. Because we already had this foundational information to realize that the issue has already been taken care of by the town. So, and because of a majority of people living in a desert community, sure, water availability is going to be top of mind, but if it's really already been handled for the next 5-10 years, let's focus on some other things. And that's where we put in this question about medical resources. And it was like the response we got, you look at the survey results, and that was just boom. The response to that particular, those questions, two or three questions, was phenomenal.
I think we have great medical here. We could use urgent care, and that kept coming out. Mm-hmm. But I mean, for a little town like this, we've got imaging, we've got a heart doctor. I mean, I take advantage of all of them here. The only thing I go to Parker for is my eye doctor, and well, I even got her that close, or him, I guess not. But I think we have great resources here. I mean, I've been through ultrasounds, I've been through x-rays, Yeah,
it's interesting, and I think that, as it came on the survey, a lot of people aren't aware of what's here.
I try to make them aware, but they don't read my stuff.
Yeah, but one of the positive consequences of this is the, I only know some of the details, maybe you know more, but from what the mayor has said publicly, that the local hospital district is looking at building new facilities here in town.
They committed $10 million to Quartzsite here in the near future for improvements of the medical facility. And a lot of it started off as a part of that initial survey that we did that kind of motivated them to focus more on Quartzsite. They're making other improvements in the county as well, but they dedicated in some fashion promised.
I think with the survey process, it was a good opportunity to hear from a lot of people.
Yeah.
Not just a handful of us saying, yeah, we need a better doctor, yeah, we need this. It was the community saying, and I think that got maybe their attention.
One of the real positive results, because there was some uncertainty going in, because we won't name names, but there's always public folks stand up at meetings and say, winter visitors, part-time residents, don't have a say in our community. Full, year-round, full-time residents are the only one that have a right to speak. Well, the survey wasn't designed that way. We did ask people to identify themselves to a smaller degree, you know, temporary being less than 6 months, more than 6 months, that type of thing. But it was fascinating to see. But the survey was put out there and to the community. And it was far and wide to everybody. But it was interesting where the responses we got back is it definitely, because it went to all the RV parks and a lot of places, the senior center, a lot of people were there are seasonal type visitors. And a lot of them did respond, but it wasn't an overwhelming amount. And even then, in some of the narrative, there was the caveat, yeah, I'm only here part of the year, but, you know. And so it was interesting to see where a lot of the folks, they recognized that. And the survey was reflective of that as well.
Well, if you're here for 6 months, you still might need a doctor.
Yeah.
Or doctor services.
You're here for
especially in the demographics and the age brackets that people are. Mm-hmm.
There's another group, too, that's important to this town that sometimes I think is overlooked, and that's the vendors. There's quite a group of vendors. They bring a lot of business in. They buy permits. And I did do some vending. I know how much they enforce the tax. And anyway, I really didn't do much here, but...
Well, the vendors would not, we would not have it, because of the timing of the survey, which was the other thing, we wanted to make sure that we didn't do it.
The vendors weren't here.
Yeah, they weren't here. But that was, in a way, that was by design, because the survey wasn't for vendors and business-related type activities. But it's an interesting challenge, though. It's an interesting question, because I think it's been a while, maybe a year, a couple of years, maybe longer.
It's big money, and of course, don't forget, we had one of the...
But what we have done, it was before my kind of seminar retired, we had a meeting with the showground people. And I think and that's kind of the avenue to communicate with the vendors.
We had a meeting today, a wrap-up meeting. We always have a wrap-up meeting after vending season. And then we plan what needs to be done next from what we're hearing, what we're seeing. And one of those things is to have another session with the showground people here shortly, and so that we can...
What is the showground people?
The people that own the showgrounds.
I mean, is that like whatever it is, or is that...
Beetle.
Tyson would be Tyson.
Well, Desert Garden.
Oh, okay, so it doesn't include all those.
Tyson,
okay,
yeah.
Thank you.
Well, yeah, well, and the other part of that, the other ingredient, is they've got to show up. They were invited.
Yeah,
they're personally invited, but they've got to show up as well.
We don't get them, but at least we get some decent input.
So the survey didn't get them, but the town reaches out directly to try to, you know, to solicit that feedback from hopefully the vendors through the owners through to the town. Because you know, that's, like you say, it's important. It's important. It has been important.
And remember, to us, the business is... property owner, the Tyson, you know, properties and the showground people. Those are the businesses that we deal with directly, because the others are tenants of their project.
Yeah, but every year the vendors pay for a permit to sell.
That's
and it. They also pay sales tax.
That's correct. They're supposed to anyway.
They do.
But they don't all do it, because yeah. I have one kind of offer me a special deal if I was just getting cash.
Well, the one
so I know
there,
some of them don't.
I kept a bowl and I always keep believe me, because I know they do enforce them here.
So that's a kind of a short, sweet summary of the general plan. So process-wise, you know, the agency input has been finished. Comment period has been finished. PNC will still have an ability to comment. Council will have an ability to comment with a recommendation to put back on the agenda for April 9th for final adoption. So it's...
one of the things, too, and I mean, I was at a meeting this last night anyway. One of the things is we've got good candidates, and we've got, you know, I think the council members have done bang up job and all, but still does, I think there's an opening on the school board. And three.
Well, not really openings, but there's three positions that will, that are up there. Yes.
Yeah, because I got a little pressure on that one, and I tried that once years ago. But anyway, we need people to get involved, and I'm talking to myself because I tend to have a fatigue problem. And if I get too involved, I get, you know, I get very exhausted. It's one of the many, many...
Exhaustion? What's exhaustion?
It's one of the many gifts that you get if you're a polio survivor, believe me. It's one of the, well, I got free tuition though, so that helped. But I want to do so much, but then I wind up just about, you know, exhausting myself for about 3 days.
Can you go over that if the general plan will or will not be on the November election?
He said the attorney was looking into that.
We do not have a final commitment on that, but the attorney has advised us that according to Arizona statute, a community has to move to an election if they had 2% growth per year for the previous 10 years.
Okay.
We have not, and therefore, if that's the case, we would not be required to take it to a general election. It would just have to be passed by the town council.
So all those old people keep dying out.
Well, that is interesting. Again, then the general plan shows the demographics. The age people are in the community are getting older. Our community is aging.
Go to any church.
Yeah.
And, well, the really good one too is the Alliance. When they have a concert, they'll fill the church up, and you will not find too many people with dark hair there, right? Even there.
Just one other important aspect that I'm going to mention here, and it'll be mentioned at the commission and the council, as long as I don't forget. If I forget, you'll remember. It's a plan. It's a 10-year plan, and in the actions, we have a goals and actions section, and like for instance, you have a specific interest in an airport, and the way the action steps are not succinctly or not comprehensively spelled out in each element of the general plan. But the town has an annual budget process, or a planning process and then a budget process, so that on an annual level, things can be put or recommended to council for it be put on the capital improvements plan or the budget grants or something like that in order to move these projects forward. There is an annual opportunity to do that. You just have to get the zoning commission and the council to agree with you, and then they can move it forward through the process. So there is a that's how these over the next 10 years, these different steps can be implemented slowly, again because we have limited resources. But that's basically how things could be implemented over time.
So when are we bringing the kids back to go to school?
We have nothing to do with the schools. You'll notice in the survey, we also did not put education in there.
But that is one of the very important things. I mean, I did raise a couple of kids years ago, and school is always very important.
The schools, it was decades ago, but I was on the Bouse Elementary School Board and the Sloan High School Board, and they go through the state legislature requires they go through a planning process and a kind of an assessment. And again, I don't know because of this district being so small if they do or not, but because of that, we intentionally left it. Other than in our vision statement, education is not in this document because it's a separate board, separate entity, separate community, because it involves Edinburgh and Quartzsite. So.
And also, with the schools not open before COVID, we did have schools here. Kids going.
Yeah,
school.
I have no idea. I can tell you we have a very vibrant after-school program, and a lot of them are homeschoolers. So I don't have any numbers for it, but there's a lot of homeschoolers. probably because of the, not being Buster, who knows how many reasons there are.
Only because I'm at after school. Some days, a third of our after school program is homeschoolers. And about, a certain percentage will also come from the Christian school. And you, when you combine those two, sometimes that's half of what we get from the public school.
Yeah, they seem at the library too, on the, in the library on a regular basis, the homeschoolers and the Christian school folks. Utilize it a lot, except for the last couple of days that I'm here.
Of course, if I were bringing up kids today, I'd be trying to figure out how I can help people.
Right.
But the next best thing is maybe get on the board.
But no, I appreciate that, and I appreciate everybody coming up. David, I wish you could have been here in the earlier sessions, but airport is in there.
That's, I'm very happy to see that, and I'm interested to see what.
There's actually an airport.
We formed an airport, the Nonprofit Airport Improvement Association many years ago to help cover the city's portion of things, both volunteers and labor and in-kind labor and cash donations from our fundraisers. We managed to put an airport in for a town of 1,000 people with.
I just have many good memories.
Nice.